and you have a movie that becomes, not something that's engaging. So I think I like that about Taika, that he was going to do it his own way, put his own touch to things. I also thought, like, this is going to be something alive and something that's going to actually, you know, work in its new medium. And so because we saw eye to eye, you know, he was taking the characters, he was taking the situation, he was building the history into it, I thought to give him the freedom to do that. I didn't feel threatened by him doing things that were different. It was almost, I saw it as a kind of, we both had a, let's say, an apartment. And so that apartment was my apartment, but I didn't want, when he was coming into the setting, to say, no, you can't put that, you know, that vase here. You can't put those curtains here. No, everything's got to be just like me. And I thought, who would even want to live in, you know, what kind of artistic freedom when you give, you know, I'd suffocate him. So Taika is very much a lively person. And I thought the best thing to do is let him fly his own way. I wouldn't have done that with, you know, anyone.
Right.
It's because I loved his work, what he did, that I thought, okay, this is what he wants to do. He told me what he wants to do. He showed me his film script. Now let Taika be Taika.
Yeah. Yeah, that's really well said. You know, and you mentioned earlier, you're right, he couldn't go into the depth of your book. It just wasn't possible. So for those listening, what he does is he creates Hitler as part of Jojo's imagination. And that kind of cuts down, I mean, a lot of that is some of the messaging in your book that he never, you know, that he couldn't get to. He does it through Hitler. Is that effective way of saying that, Christine?
Yes, it is, because he what was he going to do? Otherwise, he would have showed, let's say, Johannes, the little boy, and he would have said, this is what I'm thinking, or a voice off or something. It just wouldn't have worked. Because, you know, Johannes, he often thinks of Hitler and he sees how, you know, he's conscious of him as he does things. But Taika had actually Hitler step out of his mind, and we see the way he was, you know, engaging with Hitler and the way he became a father figure. And I thought that was an effective way of doing it.
Yeah. Did you, and I'm dying to ask you about some of the characters, one of which includes Johannes versus Jojo. So Jojo Rabbit, it's funny, it's heartwarming, it's heartbreaking, it's completely insane, and it works on every level with such a beautiful, it really truly is. When people say beautiful movie, this is the one I think about. The trailer is so amazing too. Do you have input, Christine, on the script? I know he talks to you, you know, about certain things, but I don't know how deep those conversations go. But because you are, you know, this story is your nucleus, right? This came from you. Does he ever ask you input on the script early on? Or is it one of those things where, you know what, you know, this is his project, he can do what he has to do from here?
No, he was very respectful. He sent me the script, and he showed me that there were a few things at first that I missed that I wished we could, you know, see if there was room. So I said, could I give it a try? And he said, yes. And then when I looked at it, I felt there was really no room for these scenes to actually put them in. And I thought that I wouldn't be doing a favor to the screenplay to actually try to fit it in, because everything worked like Tetris. You know, he managed to put it so compact and put so much. And then there were even things, for example, you know, in the book, there's a lot of emphasis on the shoes. And though he, you know, when people are walking on the shoes, and though he didn't put the scenes of the shoes where I had put them, he put emphasis in the shoes in such a poignant way in other ways. So, for example, when I watch the film, I see parts that aren't in the place they were in that scene, but he took a little bit of that from this scene, added it to theirs, you know. So it's almost like a painting somehow. He put this here, and let's put this detail here, and then let's put the bath scene, you know, here, and then, you know, so he moved things around, and I thought it had such a fine balance. I don't want to touch that. It just felt right to me when I read that.
Yeah, that's well said. You know, and the film was nominated for 6 Academy Awards. Taika wins for Best Adapted Screenplay. He definitely goes out of his way to thank you. Not that you're looking for kudos or congratulations, but it had to make you feel good that this movie that was nominated for Best Adapted Screenplay, that you came up with the nucleus of this movie. And I'm not trying to make this all about you, but it must be nice from a creative point of view that, you know what, this is kind of my idea that has blossomed and developed. I would say that as an author, that would be the biggest compliment to me, right? That, Christine, that's a huge thing to have, right?
Oh, yeah, so, so touching, because I saw that come out into a film. It's been made into a play. And just to think that other artists could actually take this and that it still works in other medium, because the nucleus of the story has something, you know, that's a seed that can be taken elsewhere, grafted elsewhere, and grow. I found that very powerful. And I found it very touching, because at the Oscars, he put an arm around me and his mother, and he said, these were the two women who, you know, helped me get my Oscar.
Oh, that's very sweet.
I found that very touching.
Yes.
Yeah, very sweet.
Yes. Yeah, so-
And I'm so glad that, you know, I let him do his thing, because that really paid off.
Yeah, and I almost feel like, well, I completely understand each is its own thing. Your book is its own thing. The movie is its own thing. But I also feel like in a third kind of way, you guys make a great team. I don't know if that's a, is that a inappropriate way of looking at it? Like, I feel like there's like three entities, your book, the movie, and just the way you guys kind of work with, I don't know, maybe that's, I'm being too, because of my love for movie, I'm kind of looking at things in a blurred way, Christine.
Yeah, but I even can't help that. This is the strange thing of it all. And it's really a story has a journey, because when I started writing this, I was in the Memorial Museum, you know, in Normandy. Mm. So a war museum. And I thought, you know, all those years I'm writing it. And then, you know, years later, the book came out. And then I think of Robin Cohen, that's Taika's mother,
right,
who read the book, who was very moved, who didn't let Taika have his piece for 8 months. She kept saying, you have to read this. And I thought, this is part of the story's journey. The characters actually somehow went from my book into her mind and her heart. And then she, you know, insisted that someone else, you know, her son would read it. And somehow a story has a story of its own, what happened, you know, each person who takes it. So, yeah, and I found that then just everything, the production and the way things ended up happening and the actors, you know, that would end up coming on board. Even it was strange to think that, you know, while I was writing, had someone told me, you know, that just now the actor who will play this character has just been born, you know?
Right, right.
That would have been amazing for me. What? You know, I never would have believed it at the time.
Yeah, and I have a couple questions about some characters, but before that, you brought up a great point. In your research, for those listening, is unbelievable for this book. You were looking at the type of money used, coins, the exact food, what the black market was like. Am I right with that, Christine? You were really...
Oh, yes.
That's amazing to me.
Yeah, I had all the books there because I was actually living in the Mediatek or the library there doing my research.
Mm.
So I would go from book to book. You know, there were so many volumes. But then there were some times... I remember at the end, which I kind of nicknamed my wild goose chase. It was basically, or treasure hunt even, I had about 300 questions. And I had to find these questions, but sometimes it was ridiculous. I needed to know if the post office in Vienna was open, you know, at that time. And I needed to know when credit cards came about and just, you know, little questions of everyday life, because a lot of history books, they give a lot of the facts, the war, this event. But sometimes it's just everyday life. Where would you get your, you know, your soap? How would you actually manage to get food and these kinds of everyday life? What was going on in school? What did the Hitler Youth do? What kind of games did they play? And a lot of these things I could only get through living people. And that's why it was very important for me to do the research while I could, and that I could get enough people who could give me, you know, just tell me this is what it was like, this is how cold we would be, and this is how we would get coal, or this is how we would sneak wood, and just to get a real sense of how people were managing, you know, at the time.
Yeah, and to get primary sources is invaluable, right? Because, I mean, anybody can look at something on the internet, and I get that. That's fine. But when you're looking at primary sources and people that actually were alive, that's amazing stuff, Christine.
Yeah, and we didn't have the internet like that, you know, because my novel that I just finished now, I can get some things online, you know,
sure,
and I only have to call the museum when I can't find it. But back then, there was a lot of this everyday everyday stuff, even stuff what I'd call in the realm of the home, you know, because you have a lot of war and facts and things that are, you know, what happens out in the field. But I just wanted to know how does war affect just an ordinary household in Vienna, you know, at that time? And how were things, you know, eating, sleeping, washing?
That's so well said, you know, and your research is impeccable. And it's just, you know, for those that want a career in writing, look no further. Let me ask you. So there's two characters that were not in the book that I want to bring to your attention. One was Captain Klensendorf and Fraulein Rahm. One was played by Sam Rockwell, and then Rebel Wilson. There is a beautiful scene with Captain Klensendorf at the end of the movie with Jojo, where he just tells Jojo, "You're a good human being." I love this character. I know he wasn't in the book. What's your take on Sam Rockwell and that character, and what are your thoughts on him? I just thought it added to just this wonderful, wonderful story.
I really love that character. And one of the reasons I did find the character to be very important is people tend to say often, let's say the Germans did this, or, you know, they'll refer to one country, the Americans, the Germans, the Japanese, it can be anyone. Mm-hmm. But the point is, if when you have, as you did in Germany, some people who actually went against Hitler, if you don't point out the ones that do, even if they're few, even if there's one person, if you don't point them out and you just have everyone become a collectivity, that doesn't give people incentive in future to think, if I stand out, that will make a difference. People will remember that even one person makes a difference. So it's not the Germans. It could be the Germans minus, and then however many people, you know, stood up, because some people actually did lose their life, you know, at the time. Mm. Even if it's a minority.
Sure.
So I like that point. I don't think it was to show that there can be a nice Nazi. I think it was just to show that people have a choice.
I agree.
And that
when
things like that happen, you have always a choice, and you can make a choice. You don't have to go with the collectivity at that time. Because it was always that fine balancing act, and you wonder how many people, you know, how many people really were taken, and then how many people, you know, were taken in, but how many people didn't want to be taken in, but they were too afraid. I don't know. I don't have the answer to that. I'm still always extremely shocked, you know, to see that that so many people, you know, could have been taken in and taught to hate to that extreme like that, that they just lost all sense of their humanity. And that was something I had wanted to say in the book, but it was very, very hard. I even wanted to say a little fragment of poem in the beginning, but I never managed, because for me, the victims and those who were lost were all those who lost their lives. So they're first and foremost the one I remember, and they're the tragedy. However, I do feel that by taking children who weren't hateful children, who were just normal children, and teaching them, you know, such terrible untruths, you know, that lies about other people, somehow they didn't take their lives physically, but they took something of their soul, and they took something of their humanity away from them. So they did steal something of these people, you know.
Yeah, that's so well said. Yeah, and let me ask you, for lack of a better term, so when we look at both the movie and the book, for lack of a better term, the book is a bit darker. As an author, is that tough for you to be in that place, right? Because you're very detailed in the book, you're very honest and open, it's a great read. But is it tough on you as an author to be, because like I said, a lot of this material is not uplifting, it's very difficult, it's well done, but it's difficult. Is it difficult for you?
It's dark, and I'll admit it, and it was intense. And that's something that I wouldn't change. All the more is that I was born, you know, two decades after, more or less, after the end of the war. So it was present. People talked about it. And of course, in my research, everything I saw is of such a darkness. I felt for a book, I had to be completely true to what happened. If you read, for example, Primo Levi and the conditions of what was really going on, you know, firsthand of accounts of what happens, for example, in a concentration camp, it's just terrible. And sometimes you have what I call the later generation book, Holocaust book, where people can make a for want of a better word, a kind of feel-good novel, as if in a concentration camp there was nothing but love and benevolence between each other. And yeah. that's not true to human nature. It's simply not true. Mm. And it's not about making people feel good. I think you need this kind of literature, like Celine, the author of Voyage au bout de la nuit, you know, things that are very, very dark, just as a dark reminder, this is what it's like. This is the truth of what this time is like. Let's never go there again. Now, I understand for a film had a different take, because though Taika took some... he took comedy, the laughs, you know, aren't free. You laugh and then you think about it and then you feel it. So, but for the book, I felt the book really had to have an element that was true to how the time and the era had been, you know, through my research and through just the reality and the truth that it was. It was just a horrific time. I mean, can you imagine a whole industrial extermination of, you know, 6 million Jews? How can you do that and then actually, you know, make something that is anything but dark and have been true to it?
No, Christine, I completely agree. And again, your book is a work of art. Let me ask you, so where Taika really has fun here, you know, looking at your book in the movie, is when we look at Yorkie and Kippy, right? Kippy doesn't last long in the book. Yorkie melts your heart in the movie with limitless luck and the gentle wit one-liners he has, you know. The one at the end where he says it's not a very good time to be a Nazi. It's just the sweet way this child just eases through the movie. In the book, you know, not so much, you know, doesn't last too long. What's your take on that character, Christine?
Yeah, now there's something interesting, and I did think about that, because Jojo and, you know, Yorkie, they're so endearing. And it's an interesting thing, because there is a moment where Jojo goes to see Elsa, and he has his Hitler youth knife, and he actually goes, he has such pain and anger on his face, and he actually goes to her throat, and he actually cuts her. Do you remember
that?
Yeah, I do. And you actually see that she's bleeding, and it's a terrible scene, and it's actually dark. But somehow, when you have a film and you have the visual of an endearing face, you actually notice that less. And in a book, that's interesting, because in the book, I have him put the knife against her throat. He doesn't draw blood, but it's much darker all the same, because you don't have the face. I just thought that's an interesting fact when you compare the two, that in the there are some cruel things, you know, in the film that he does, and yet you get the cruelty less because of you have a sweetness at other times, and then it reminds you visually that actually these were nothing but children. I thought that was quite interesting. Fraulein Ram, by the way, the teacher, there is the teacher in the book. It was when his teacher, Herr Grassi, was replaced by Fraulein Ram.
Yes.
But she's just the teacher, and she just starts teaching basically racism and what do you call it, eugenics.
Yes.
She starts teaching them that. And so it's quite harsh in the book, because I actually took what they were teaching the children, which is just horrific to, you know, be teaching that the, you know, comparing the Jews to Satan, to be talking about Africans, you know, with the kind of terminology that they were using and the charts. It's just so untrue and horrific and beyond belief. But so I did put that there. So the teacher is in the book, but she's not funny at all.
No, you're right. You are correct. I stand corrected. I should have rephrased it. Taika brought it to kind of another level. It's almost the way Taika's version of it and your version of it, again, very different, but you are correct.
You couldn't say it. I'll mention that. In the film, it was so offensive to say the teaching, you know, what they were teaching.
Right.
It was so offensive that wouldn't have been bearable in the film.
Yes.
In the book, it's extremely, I mean, I can't even read that without, you know, feeling unwell. But because the book takes history, and that was its aim, to take history literally and be factual, I felt there's room for that in the book as more of a educational tool, I'd say.
Yeah,
you know, to put the education and to be true to the history at that time, and not to soft soap it. I didn't want to soft soap it. It wasn't said in any other way than the way I said it, you know. And I had the books as first source material, and I wanted that to be recorded. That's what children were being taught in school. You know, how did these children start to believe that it was okay to do this? Well, that's what they were taught. It just, sometimes I even think to myself, you know, I ended up having teenage boys. I wasn't a mother at the time, but I thought to myself, if my kids went to school and that's what they would be teaching my children, you know, as primary school kids or elementary, you know, school kids at school. And if I would complain, the Gestapo would come get me, you know, and kill me.
That's right.
It was just a horrific situation to be in. But children would actually trust and believe those educators, because educators have a responsibility, you know, by teaching the future generation what they tell them. So I think part of the message of the book, too, is just how important education is. Because what they did to these children is horrible. But if we want to live in a much better world and teach each other, you know, to cherish the diversity, and that we're, how our humanity is what we have in common, and that we feel similar things that need to be cherished and valued and loved. If that's what we're teaching children at an early age, that shows how education is so important. That's the right way to go to a better world. So I think by showing the worst things you can teach, you can also have hope that by teaching, you know, at the earliest age, the most important things there is to teach, that, you know, to start to wipe out these residues that have seemed to come back of some of these thought patterns that are unacceptable.
Yeah, and Christine, you could even add, obviously, parenting to that too, right? Because in the movie, Rosie is the ideal. I mean, Jojo realizes how very special his mother was, right? You can even add parenting by what she did, and when he comes to realize that. Could you throw parenting in there as well, Christine?
Sorry?
Could you throw parenting? You mentioned education.
Oh, yes.
Parenting is just as important.
Parenting, because the parenting can teach children instantly the right way to view other people with kindness and with empathy and with respect. And I think parenting is hugely important. I also think that science has a huge role to play, because at the time the Nazis used pseudoscience. It was just absolute fake science to go and say that the form of the skull has anything to do with superiority or intelligence. If it were real science, science would be teaching, you know, people of different ethnicities. You could have the same blood type. You could fully transfuse your blood into each other and you would fully live. Mm-hmm. You know, basically, we have so much in common. And science would be playing a role, that this was not scientific what they were saying, and that you know, emotions, human feelings, this is what makes us human. It's not measuring the size of, what was it, someone's nose and someone's, how wide the head is. I mean, that's ridiculous.
Insane.
If anything, the Nazis showed people who were brave and people who had heart. That made the difference.
That's well said. You know, and the last question about characters was Jojo versus Johannes. I almost feel, part of its age, I get that, where they were. But the likability factor, I feel like Johannes is so much more unlikable. Is that a fair way of looking at it, Christine, versus
yes.
Jojo? Part of it's age, too, because where Johannes ends in the book and where Jojo ends in the book, it's kind of, you know, there's a good, I want to say, 6-7 years difference. But likability, I think, is there, right?
Yes. And what would be necessary, that I found very necessary when I brought about the character of Johannes, is I star him when he's playing kites. So you can see a very short glimpse of what he was like before, when he has that warm relationship with his mother before the Hitler Youth. But then what I had done is I'd watched documentaries. And if you ever, you can look that up on YouTube. They're there. You just put the Hitler Youth when they were rounded up. Look at those faces of the Hitler Youth and the Jungfolk. The Jungfolk were the younger branch of the Hitler Youth. You look at those faces and it's incredible, because there's such a hardness built into those faces, as if they were at the youngest age, try to take, you know, the warmth taken out of them. And that's one of the things with Johannes. I wanted to make it true to the kind of training that he had, so that he would have a long way to go, because he does have a long way to go to realize that actually he was taught things that were wrong. And also to even show that people who were taught things that were wrong as a child almost feel guilty when they start to learn that that's not right, but then they start to go against what they were taught, as if there's some fundamental core in us, a hard drive almost, when we're children. And if they're taught the wrong thing, you feel guilt when you start to go against that, what you were taught in school or taught by your parents.
No, that is so well said. Again, geez, I mean, you're making me kind of think about all of the, you're absolutely correct. My last question to you is, the very first time, you know, when we all read a book, right, we'll just, whether it's, you know, a book that you've done, whether it's, you know, Caging Skies or what have you, we all have an idea of what a character looks like in our own minds, right? That's part of the special uniqueness of reading. When you first see the movie for the very first time, and Taika's put faces on these wonderful characters that you've created, what's it like for you that very first time? Is it emotional for you? Are you looking for details? Can you sit back and enjoy it? Are you nervous? Is it all of the above?
It was overwhelming. I was very emotional because, well, before the film came out, it was they had adapted it to a play. So it was the first time I had seen the characters, you know, in front of me, you know, in the theater. Okay, so this was the second time, but now it's on the big screen. So, you know, you're really close up and you see each character's face. Or one of the first things is you're hearing the bombing. And when I was in the museum, I had a soundtrack of the bombing. So that actually brings me back to when I was just researching this whole thing as an act of faith, never knowing if it's going to be published. And suddenly, you know, as I'm hearing exactly what sounds to me like my soundtrack at the museum that went off every 10 minutes, I'm back there, you know, as a younger writer, just, you know, doing my research. So I have all these, it brings my whole journey to me. So there's parts where it was extremely true to the era and the decoration and the Hitler flags, and that looked just like images that I had seen in my book. So again, that's bringing me back to my research and to see, you know, so many people had worked again to recreate that. That was extremely moving and poignant. And then to actually see, you know, the moment, you know, as I'm discovering it, I know, you know, that when Johannes is going there, he's going to at some stage discover Elsa, but you know, the moment where he you know, screams, she screams, you know, that you have all these moments between each other. She doesn't scream, she's more just you know, I take that back, she's more feeling interior, the so yeah, it was discovering it, very moved by such beautiful cinematography, and I felt such a huge effort had been put into scene after scene after scene to bring this alive and bring these characters. And I felt that, you know, each actor had done the best that they possibly could. When there's the moment with the mother, you know, I don't want to give away, but that very sad moment.
Yes.
Was just, oh my goodness.
Yes.
And then to see, you know, Johannes reacting to that moment, I could hardly even watch. My heart was breaking.
Yeah.
Because I'm discovering it, though I know that happens. I could never see that and watch it, you know, before my eyes without, you know, feeling such strong emotion from
it. And I think Taika had a tough time shooting that scene, too. He was, you know, it's a very difficult scene, obviously. I'll be careful what I say. But, yeah, I mean, there's so many moments, Christine, that are just, you know, it's just. But I have to say, this is one of those movies I really feel like that should be shown in schools, that people should really. Because, I mean, everyone that I know and that I've recommended this to absolutely loves it. And you have to be happy that people are discovering you because of this movie, which leads me to my very last thing I will say before I let you go. You've been so generous with all this time. Please tell me what's ahead for you. You mentioned a book in January. I would love to hear what's around the corner for you. Very excited to get involved in what's ahead for you.
Oh, thank you very much. So the next one, it's called In Amber's Wake. And this one is set, I'll just say, at the time of the Rainbow Warrior bombing.
Okay.
So I can say it's a messy love story. And the Rainbow Warrior bombing, that's just in the background, but it weaves into the story in its own way. So it's historical and it has its own themes. Probably as a book, it's closer in writing, or in the how my process was, it was closer to writing Caging Skies because it was historical. That always takes a bit more work because you have to research it and then you have to interweave, you know, the what's happening with the characters, which with what's happening in the background. So that's the next one.
Yeah, and I have to say, Christine, it's been an absolute joy to have you on the show today. I could not have had a better time with you, and I cannot thank you enough.
Oh, Derek, thank you so much. It's been a real pleasure for me to talk to you.
Dann kamst du.